Assalamu alaikum students, a very good morning to you all. I hope you all are fine and doing great. So we are done with the first line anti-tuberculous drugs and I hope you have gone through them you have memorized the names of the first and second line anti-tuberculous drugs. So today we'll be doing the second line anti-tuberculous drugs and the remaining antimycobacterial drugs, the drugs which are used in the treatment of non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections and leprosy. So let's get started. Let's check out today's learning objectives first. And I hope you all are having your copy and pen by your side and you will be writing down the important points. So by the end of today's lecture, you should be able to enumerate the second line drugs used to treat tuberculosis. Write down the treatment of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis and enumerate the drugs used to treat atypical mycobacterial infections, which are also known as non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections, and should be able to write down the prophylaxis and treatment of disseminated Mycobacterium avium complex disease. Name the drugs used to treat leprosy, which is also known as Hansen's disease, and write down a note on dapsone and clofazimine. These all are important university questions as well. So the second line anti-tuberculous drugs, before starting them, let's revise the first line anti-tuberculous drugs, which were isoniazid, rifampin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide and streptomycin. And you have to remember that in some books streptomycin is written in first line drugs and in others in second line. But if you see the treatment regimen, the four drugs which are used in treatment regimens, those were the isoniazid, rifampin, ethambutol and pyrazinamide. Streptomycin is usually given if patient is not able to tolerate any of those four drugs. So second line agents are considered only if there is resistance to the first line agents. There is resistance either to a single drug or there is multi-drug resistance, extended drug resistance, and you already know by now what is multi-drug resistance and what is extended drug resistance, right? If there is failure of clinical response to the conventional therapy or there are serious treatment limiting adverse drug reactions, like the patient has developed severe hepatotoxicity or SLE, then you will stop any one of the drugs from the first line and you will add on any drug from second line. Clear? So last time we did the second line agents, let's revise them. You can use this mnemonic to memorize the names of the second line drugs. This is fake Perl, but for K we will use C. Clear? F is fluoroquinolones, moxifloxacin, levofloxacin, ciprofloxacin. Mostly moxifloxacin is used. It is most active against the Mycobacterium tuberculosis, followed by levofloxacin and then ciprofloxacin. A is for aminoglycosides, capreomycin, amikacin, kanamycin, and you know these drugs are given through parenteral route. C, cell wall synthesis inhibitors like cycloserine and carbapenems. E, ethionamide. P is pretominid, A is aminosalicylic acid, R rifamycin derivatives, rifabutin and rifapentin, and L is linezolid. Bedaquiline is also an important second line agent. We'll discuss only important points about these drugs, especially their mechanism of action. Ethionamide is related to isoniazid and it inhibits the synthesis of mycolic acid. You can see the structural similarity between the two drugs. It is given only orally, is metabolized by liver and used for the treatment of multi-drug resistant and extended drug resistant tuberculosis. Its adverse effects include gastric irritation, which can lead to anorexia, nausea, vomiting, hepatotoxicity and neurological symptoms, just like the ones experienced with isoniazid. And neurological symptoms include depression, dizziness, drowsiness, asthenia, paresthesias, headache, restlessness and tremors. And concomitant administration of pyridoxine, which is vitamin B6, is recommended to relieve the neurological symptoms. And there is a cross resistance between isoniazid and ethionamide, means if a mycobacteria is resistant to isoniazid, it will be resistant to ethionamide as well. Capreomycin is obtained from Streptomyces capreolus and is a protein synthesis inhibitor. It is an injectable agent for the treatment of multi-drug resistance tuberculosis, and it is usually given intramuscularly. The mycobacteria resistant to streptomycin are usually susceptible to capreomycin, but there is cross resistance between capreomycin, kanamycin and amikacin. Means if there is a capreomycin resistant strain, it would be resistant to amikacin and kanamycin too. The adverse effects are ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity as with other aminoglycosides. In ototoxicity, the patient may experience tinnitus, deafness or vestibular disturbance. And the injection may cause local pain and sterile abscess may develop. Kanamycin is used in the treatment of tuberculosis caused by streptomycin resistant strains, and it is more toxic as compared to other aminoglycosides used for the treatment of tuberculosis. Amikacin is used to treat streptomycin resistant and multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, and it is also active against atypical mycobacteria, which are the non-tuberculous mycobacteria. And it is resistant to the kanamycin resistant strains. Cycloserine is a cell wall synthesis inhibitor. It is a structural analog of D-alanine. It is eliminated renally. It can produce peripheral neuropathy, depression, and psychosis. Pyridoxine should be given along with the drug because it ameliorates the neurotoxicity. And the neuropsychiatric symptoms produced by cycloserine are so common that the drug has earned the nickname of psychserine. And these symptoms, they range from headache and somnolence to severe psychosis, seizures and suicidal ideas. So cycloserine must be used with caution in a patient of depression, and it is contraindicated in patients having history of epilepsy. Clear? Minosalicylic acid or paraminosalicylic acid is structurally similar to PABA, which is paraminobenzoic acid. It is a folate synthesis antagonist, means it is inhibiting the synthesis of folic acid as it blocks the enzyme dihydroteroate synthase. It is a bacteriostatic drug. It is widely distributed in the body tissues and fluids except for CSF. It is one of the oldest antimicrobacterial drugs. It is excreted in urine and it can cause crystallurea. Its adverse effects include GI symptoms, peptic ulcer, and hemorrhage. And hypersensitivity reactions may occur, which are characterized by fever, joint pains, rash, hepatosplenomegaly, adenopathy, and granulocytopenia. And if hypersensitivity reactions do occur, the drug should be stopped immediately. The next group is fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin, gatifloxacin, levofloxacin and moxifloxacin. They are active against gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, mycobacterium tuberculosis and atypical mycobacteria. Moxifloxacin is the most active fluoroquinolone against mycobacterium tuberculosis, followed by levofloxacin and ciprofloxacin. Ciprofloxacin has more activity against the atypical mycobacteria. Fluoroquinolones are used in the treatment of pulmonary tuberculosis and also in the treatment of tuberculous meningitis. Most of the second line agents have been told to you previously, therefore we won't be going into their detail. Okay, we are only discussing the important points. Linezolid is a protein synthesis inhibitor and it binds to the 50S ribosomal subunit. It is used in the treatment of extended drug resistance tuberculosis and it can produce bone marrow suppression, irreversible peripheral and optic neuropathy. Bedaquiline is a newer drug. It inhibits ATP synthase in mycobacteria and is bactericidal. It is approved for TB resistant to both isoniazid and rifampin, which means it is used for the treatment of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Its adverse effects include nausea, arthralgia, headache, cardiotoxicity and hepatotoxicity. FDA has issued a black box warning due to the risk of QT prolongation and associated mortality due to use of this drug. Therefore, ECG monitoring is really important when the patient is using bedaquiline. And therefore, it is reserved for the patients who do not have other treatment options. So the point to remember is it is ATP synthase inhibitor and it is used for the treatment of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis and can produce QT prolongation. Pretominid is also a newer agent. It is nitroimidazole derivative and is structurally related to metronidazole. It is used for the treatment of multi-drug and extended drug resistant tuberculosis. It inhibits Mycobacterium tuberculosis, mycolic acid and protein synthesis. Now the rifamycin derivatives, rifabutin and rifapentin. Rifabutin is a rifamycin derivative and is related to rifampin. There is complete cross resistance with rifampin, means if mycobacteria is resistant to rifampin, it would be resistant to other rifamycin derivatives as well. It is a less potent cytochrome P450 inducer, therefore there would be less drug interactions as compared to rifampin. It is basically used for the treatment of tuberculosis in HIV patients who are taking protease inhibitors or non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors because it will produce less induction of cytochrome P450. It is also used for prevention and treatment of disseminated atypical mycobacterial infections in AIDS patients. So these are its two clinical uses. If a patient is having HIV and is on treatment for HIV, then instead of rifampin, we give rifabutin because it is a less potent cytochrome P450 inducer. Rifapentin is a rifampin analog and there is complete cross resistance with rifampin. It is used for the treatment of tuberculosis caused by rifampin susceptible strain during continuation phase only. Then there is another drug which is a rifampin derivative. It is rifamycin, but it has no antimicrobacterial activity. It is not absorbed from GIT and thus is used for the prevention of hepatic encephalopathy, for the treatment of traveler's diarrhea by non-invasive E. coli, and it can also be used to treat irritable bowel syndrome and Clostridium difficile colitis or pseudomembranous colitis not responsive to other drugs. These two are its off-label uses. So you can be asked that what is rifamycin because it is not having any antimicrobacterial activity. Clear? This is a very beautiful diagram showing the mechanism of action of all the antimicrobacterial drugs, the first line, the second line. So you can see this is a mycobacterium, this is its cell wall, cell membrane, its DNA, and the mechanism of action of all of the drugs, including the first line, isoniazid, ethambutol, pyrazinamide, rifampin, streptomycin, and the second line, ethionamide, fluoroquinolones, bicyclic nitromidazole, which is pretominid, bedaquiline, and oxazolidinones, which is linezolid. So you can revise the mechanism of action of all the drugs from this diagram. So we are done with antimicrobacterial agents. Now the second part of the lecture, which is drugs used for the treatment of non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections, which were previously known as atypical mycobacterial infections. So non-tuberculous mycobacteria, they have distinctive lab characteristics. They are present in the environment, in the soil, water, and are generally not communicable from person to person. This is a very important point to remember. They are usually less susceptible to anti-tuberculous drugs as compared to Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and active infection should be treated with combinations of drugs to avoid resistance. So these are the drug groups used for the treatment of non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections. Macrolides including clarithromycin, azithromycin, tetracyclines like doxycycline, minocycline, aminoglycosides like amikacin, streptomycin, sulfonamides, trimethoprim, sulfamethoxazole, fluoroquinolones like moxifloxacin, and the drugs which were used for the treatment of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, they can also be used for the treatment of non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections like isoniazid, rifampin and ethambutol, but pyrazinamide cannot be used. So let's check out the treatment regimen for Mycobacterial Kansasi infection. The Mycobacterial Kansasi infection, it resembles the Mycobacterium tuberculosis infection, but it is milder. The drugs used for the treatment are isoniazid plus rifampin plus ethambutol. These three drugs are used to avoid the development of resistance. Clear? Next is Mycobacterium avium complex infection. It includes both Mycobacterium avium and Mycobacterium intracellulare. And it produces pulmonary disease in patients with lung disease and in patients with AIDS. So the therapy is with azithro or clarithromycin plus ethambutol and rifampin. So we use a macrolide, ethambutol and rifampin. And if the patient is on the treatment of HIV, then instead of rifampin, we will use rifabutin. So, Mycobacterium avium complex is important cause of development of disseminated disease in the later stages of AIDS. And for prevention of disseminated Mycobacterium avium complex in AIDS patients with low CD4 cell count, we give azithromycin or clarithromycin with or without rifabutin. Usually azithro or clarithromycin is used. And for the treatment of disseminated Mycobacterium avium complex infection in AIDS patients, we give azithro or clarithromycin plus ethambutol plus rifabutin. And if needed, a fourth drug is given, which could be amikacin or streptomycin or ciprolevo or moxifloxacin. Clear? So this was the main treatment of Mycobacterium avium complex, a macrolide, ethambutol and rifabutin in case of patients taking treatment of AIDS. And if we need to add one other drug, we can add an aminoglycoside or a fluoroquinolone, and the treatment is given for 1 year. Clear? So infections resulting from other non-tuberculous mycobacteria like Mycobacterium marinum, Mycobacterium ulcerans, these produce cutaneous infections, may be treated with antimicrobial drugs, ethambutol, isoniazid, rifampin, or other antibiotics which are discussed earlier. We are done with the drugs used to treat tuberculosis and non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections. Now let's go through the last part of the session, which is anti-leprosy drugs. But before discussing the drugs, let's have a quick overview of leprosy. Leprosy is also known as Hansen's disease, and it is a chronic infectious disease caused by Mycobacterium leprae, which is an obligate intracellular pathogen. It has been considered incurable disease since ages and was once feared as a highly contagious and devastating disease, and still it bears a lot of social stigma and those suffering from the disease are isolated. The global prevalence has markedly declined over the few years due to global initiative of WHO to eliminate leprosy by providing multi-drug therapy free of charge. But still, it is very common in India, Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Brazil. In Pakistan, still there are many cases of leprosy, especially in Karachi. In Lahore, the biggest leprosy center is in Mayo Hospital, and all the patients are sent there for the lab testing for the diagnosis of the disease. It is a chronic and progressive disease, and the bacteria grows very slowly, and it may take up to 20 years to develop signs of infection. The disease can affect the nerves, skin, eyes and mucous membranes. The nerves, they may get thickened, as you can see the greater auricular nerve here. You can palpate the radial, ulnar or other nerves of the patient, which are normally non-palpable and they cannot be seen as well. It can affect the skin. The patient can present with nodules or patches. Patches can be light colored, hyperpigmented or erythematous, and there is loss of sensation in the affected area. The sense of pain, the sense of touch is lost, and the patient cannot feel the cannot discriminate between the temperature changes as well. He cannot feel the hot or cold things over that area. Corneal ulcers can also be produced, and if left untreated, it can produce crippling and the paralysis of hands and feet. It can produce blindness due to uveitis and iridocyclitis, and saddle nose deformity due to destruction of nasal cartilage, and there is destruction of other bony structures as well. And these deformities, they cannot be reversed. Although the treatment can cure the disease, but these deformities cannot be reversed. But early diagnosis and treatment usually prevents the disability resulting from the disease. Clear? Leprosy is basically of four types. Tuberculoid leprosy, in which the cell-mediated immunity is normal. Borderline tuberculoid, borderline lepromatous, and lepromatous leprosy, in which the cell-mediated immunity is decreased, and this is the most severe form of leprosy. Leprosy can also be divided into possibacillary and multibacillary. In possibacillary, the patient has few Mycobacterium leprae bacilli, and the patient is non-infectious. Possibacillary includes tuberculoid and borderline tuberculoid leprosy, and in multibacillary, the patient has a large bacillary load and is infectious, and it includes the borderline lepromatous and lepromatous leprosy. So the drugs used for treatment of leprosy, you can memorize it by a mnemonic: soap. The sulfone derivative, which is Dapsone, this is the most common and most important drug. It is the cheapest and it is the most commonly used drug for the treatment of leprosy. Other antibiotics like ofloxacin, moxifloxacin, minocycline, and clarithromycin. Antitubercular drugs like rifampin and ethionamide. And phenazine derivative, clofazimine. So, soap. Dapsone, rifampin, and clofazimine are the most important drugs for the treatment of leprosy. So let's discuss Dapsone. It is important from examination point of view as well. It is a structural analog of PABA, para-aminobenzoic acid, and is related to sulfonamide. So it would be folate antagonist. It is a diaminodiphenyl sulfone, DDS, and resistance emerge if low doses are given. So for the treatment of all the mycobacterial infections, we never give a single drug. We always give drugs in combination therapy to prevent the development of resistance. This is the structure of Dapsone. It is well absorbed from gut and is widely distributed to body tissues and fluids. Its half-life is 1 to 2 days. Therefore, it is given once daily, 100 milligram of the drug is given once daily. It is retained in the skin, muscle, liver, and kidney, undergoes enterohepatic cycling, and is eliminated in urine partly as acetylated metabolites. It is a competitive inhibitor of dihydroteroate synthase and inhibits folate synthesis. This is important. It also has anti-inflammatory action. It inhibits the tissue damage by neutrophils by inhibiting the activity of neutrophil myeloperoxidase and lysosomal enzymes, and by acting as scavenger of free radicals generated by neutrophils, and by inhibiting the migration of neutrophils to inflammatory lesions. So basically, it is decreasing the tissue damage by neutrophils and thus also has anti-inflammatory actions. Its anti-leprotic action is basically because of inhibition of folic acid synthesis, and its anti-inflammatory action is utilized in some other disorders, which we will see shortly. So you can see here that Dapsone is inhibiting dihydroteroate synthase, and thus it inhibits the synthesis of folic acid. It is a broad spectrum antibiotic. It is active against the Mycobacterium leprae, some fungi, and parasites as well. So it is used for the treatment of leprosy in combination with rifampin and clofazimine. This is its most important and common use. It is also used for the prevention and treatment of pneumocystis jirovecii pneumonia in AIDS patients. This is a fungal pneumonia. It is used for the prophylaxis of Toxoplasma gondii, which is a parasite, and in combination with chlorpromazine for the treatment of malaria. This is also a parasitic disease. Clear? So, owing to its anti-inflammatory action, it is used for the treatment of pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, linear IgA bullous disease, and relapsing chondritis. In older days, it was also used for the treatment of acne. AC dapsone is a repository form of dapsone that provides inhibitory plasma concentrations for several months. You can get this in your exams. Which drug is a repository form of dapsone in multiple choice questions, and that is AC dapsone. Adverse effects of dapsone are really important and they are often asked in exam. It can produce hemolysis, especially in patients with glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. Methemoglobinemia may occur. It can produce GI intolerance and fever. Because it is a sulfur drug, it can produce pruritus and rash. And erythema nodosum leprosum may occur, which is the formation of nodules due to drug therapy. And this occurs while treating lepromatous leprosy. And this is a lepra reaction. And it occurs due to release of antigen from the killed bacilli. And this can be suppressed by giving corticosteroids or thalidomide. You can get this in multiple choice question, that which drugs are used to treat erythema nodosum leprosum. So we never give dapsone for erythema nodosum leprosum, because dapsone is the cause of development of erythema nodosum leprosum. We'll give corticosteroids or thalidomide instead. Clear? So next drug is clofazimine. It is a phenazine dye. It is excreted in feces. It is stored widely in reticuloendothelial tissues and skin and is slowly released, and its half-life is up to 2 months. It has a very long half-life. Clofazimine is used in the treatment of multibacillary leprosy along with rifampin and dapsone. It is also used for the treatment of reactions in leprosy like reversal reaction and erythema nodosum leprosum. It is also used to treat dapsone-resistant leprosy along with other antibiotics that are used in resistant cases like fluoroquinolone, oxifloxacin or moxifloxacin, macrolides, and minocycline. Its adverse effects are brown to black skin discoloration, dry and scaly skin, which is also known as ichthyosis, discoloration of conjunctiva, and GI intolerance. And all these adverse effects are reversible. Now, the regimen for the treatment of leprosy, multi-drug therapy is used to reduce the development of resistance and to reduce the duration of therapy. And our objective is total cure of the disease. If the patient is having possibacillary leprosy, then dapsone and rifampin are used in combination for 6 months. 100 mg of dapsone is given daily and 600 mg of rifampin is given once a month for 6 months. And for multibacillary leprosy, we give a combination of dapsone, rifampin, and clofazimine for a year. 100 mg of dapsone is given daily, 600 mg of rifampin is given once a month, and 300 mg of clofazimine is given once a month, followed by 50 mg of clofazimine daily. And this is for 1 year. Clear? And what are the treatment of different reactions in leprosy? There are two types of reactions, reversal reactions and erythema nodosum leprosum, which is also known as lepra reaction. Reversal reaction is the manifestation of delayed hypersensitivity to antigens of Mycobacterium lepra, and it occurs in tuberculoid leprosy. And there is cutaneous ulceration and nerve involvement, and we give corticosteroids and clofazimine for treatment. Clofazimine is given because it also has anti-inflammatory action and it can treat these reactions. So for erythema nodosum leprosum, which occurs due to release of antigens from killed bacilli. This is produced due to therapy. It is associated with therapy. There is formation of tender nodules and patient may present with high-grade fever. So we give clofazimine and thalidomide, and corticosteroids can also be given. But thalidomide is not given in reversal reaction in tuberculoid leprosy. We are done with the treatment of all of the mycobacterial infectious diseases. Now is the time for quiz. I want you to write down the question numbers only and their answers and then submit them in your WhatsApp group for attendance. A 50-year-old male attends the hospital OPD with multiple diffuse nodules over the face and arms for the past 1 month. The skin over the lesions is reddish and glossy, and sensation over face and arms is diminished and the ulnar nerve is thickened. The skin smear is positive for Mycobacterium leprae. So the diagnosis of leprosy was made. And now you have to write down the treatment regimen. I want you to write down the treatment regimen for possibacillary and multibacillary leprosy, both. Now MCQs, just write down the question numbers and their answers. A patient with AIDS has persistent fever and weight loss associated with invasive pulmonary disease due to Mycobacterium avium complex. Optimal management of this patient is to once weekly administration of which of the following antibiotics has prophylactic activity against bacteremia caused by Mycobacterium avium complex in AIDS patient. The keyword here is once weekly. Which of the following is correct regarding clofazimine in the treatment of leprosy? Well, that's all for today. I hope you have understood the topic. If you have any questions, you can ask them in your WhatsApp group and I'll get back to you as soon as possible. Go through the lecture properly. Have a great day. Take care of yourselves. Allah Hafiz.